I call this meeting of the Williamsburg James City County to order. Ms. Serza, could you take the roll?
Ms. Cook.
Here.
Ms. Hummel.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here.
Ms. Ownby.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Dr. Beers is absent.
Can I get a motion for approval of the agenda as presented?
You want to certify, please?
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Do you want me to?
Yeah, let's, can you give me a motion for certification?
I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Is there a second?
I second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. We've already taken the roll, so that moves us to the approval of the agenda. Can I get a motion for approval of the agenda?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Thank you. That takes us to 4.01, appointment of chair, vice chair, and parliamentarian. For this, I turn this gavel over to Dr. Heron.
In accordance with the Code of Virginia, the board must select one of its members as chair for the period of 1 year. Could I have a motion to open the floor for nominations for chair of the school board to serve for the calendar year 2017?
Dr. Heron, I enthusiastically nominate Kara Cook for the position of WJCC school board chair.
I think the first thing you need is a motion for opening of the nominations.
Opening the floor for nominations,
first of
all.
So I move to open the nominations.
Thank you. Now, could I have nominations for the chair of the school board?
Dr. Heron, I enthusiastically nominate Kara Cook for the position of WJCC school board chair.
Are there any other nominations? Could I have a motion to close the nomination process?
So moved.
Ms. Serza, call the roll, please.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Kara Cook has been nominated for the chair of the Williamsburg James City County School Board for the 2017 calendar year. Ms. Serza, please call the roll, please.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Congratulations, Ms. Cook, on being appointed as the Williamsburg James City County School Board Chair for the calendar year 2017.
Thank you all very much. The next item on the agenda is appointment of vice chair. I would like to ask for nominations for the vice chair of the school board to serve for the calendar year for 2017. Do I have any nominations?
Madam Chair, I nominate Ms. Holly Taylor for vice chair.
Are there any other nominations? Can I have a motion to close nominations?
So moved.
Ms. Serza, can you take a vote on closing nominations? Call the roll on closing nominations, please.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. So I'd like Ms. Serza to call the roll and ask all those in favor of Ms. Holly Taylor being vice chair of the Williamsburg James City County School Board for the 2017 calendar year to signify by saying aye.
Please call Mr. the roll. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mrs. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. Next on the agenda is the appointment of... Congratulations, Mrs. Taylor. I'm sorry. much. Forgive me. Next is nominations for parliamentarian of the school board to serve for the calendar year 2017. Can I ask for nominations, please?
I would like to nominate Julie Hummel for parliamentarian.
Other nominations? Can I have a motion to close nominations, please?
So moved.
Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please, to close nominations? Thank you.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. So all those in favor of Ms. Julie Hummel being parliamentarian for the Williamsburg-James City County School Board for the 2017 calendar year, please signify to Ms. Serza by saying aye. Would you call the roll, Ms. Serza, please?
Ms. Young?
Aye.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Congratulations, Ms. Hummel. So next up is item 4.02. In accordance with the Code of Virginia, it's recommended that it requires us to appoint a clerk, a deputy clerk, and superintendent's designee. And the recommendation is to that Ms. Janet Serza be appointed as clerk, Ms. Pamela Hayworth be appointed as deputy clerk of the Williamsburg-James City County School Board through 2017. It is also recommended that Ms. Christina Berta, CFO of WJCC Public Schools, be designated to attend meetings of the school board in the absence or inability of the superintendent to attend. May I have a motion, please?
Madam Chair, can I motion for approval of the appointment of Ms. Serza as our clerk, Ms. Hayworth as our deputy clerk, and Mrs. Berta to serve as superintendent's designee?
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please?
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Next item is 4.03, approval of schedule of school board meetings for 2017. Can I have a motion, please?
Madam Chair, I motion for approval of the WJCC County School Board 2017 meeting dates as presented.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Yes. Hi, thanks. I just wanted to point out that, and maybe it's fine, but that there on the November 14th work session, the next one is the 21st of November, which falls directly before Thanksgiving and is not a two-week, usually they're 2 weeks apart, and I didn't know whether that was... if someone could just...
Yeah, the first Tuesday is Election Day.
Oh, okay. So that would be the November 14th, which is fine. But then it's the November 21st, which I'm wondering, should that be the 28th?
We need to check our calendars because the 30th might be Thanksgiving.
No, the 23rd is Thanksgiving. According to my Google calendar, maybe I'm wrong. That's why I was just looking at Thanksgiving 2017 is November 23rd, and our regular meeting is the 21st.
Okay.
So I'm just wondering whether or not we should consider making that regular meeting the 28th instead of the 24th, which would make it 2 weeks after the 14th, and then... But I didn't know whether that was. Okay. Didn't know whether
have a problem, an objection to that?
I mean, was there a reason for it being
It's usually the first and third.
Okay.
So
we couldn't do it on the first because of election.
That's been our custom.
Right. Okay. I guess I'm recommending doing it.
Changing the 21st to the 20th. Any objection to that? Logistical reason that might be a challenge for the division?
Not that I'm aware of.
IP.
Release of the agenda on Friday before.
We can make it happen if it's the board's desire.
I just didn't know whether it would be easier not to have a meeting the Tuesday before Thanksgiving to have it the following.
So, okay. And so I sense an amendment coming. So, but before that, I'd like to, I don't have a problem with it, but since we're beating the November meetings up, on the 14th, I am out of town for work and unable to attend. So,
the 14th.
The gavel will be in your hands, your capable hands. So, and I'm fine with that. I can watch.
And then also, I'm not going to be in town on March 7th. That's William & Mary's spring break week.
Someone, would you like to make an amendment to the...
Sure, that's okay.
You made the motion.
I made the motion.
So do you want to amend your own motion, or do you want
to... I can amend the motion to move the meeting from the November 21st to November 28th. I'm good with that.
Any objections to that?
As long as the person who seconded it, that was good.
That was good. Everybody think it's good?
Everybody thinks it's great.
Sirza, will you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Thank you. Next up is 4.04, appointment of school board member to serve as trustee on the New Horizons Board. If it pleases the board, I'd like to follow a similar method to the way we developed the appointment of chair, vice chair, and parliamentarian, rather than and just ask for nominations, close the nominations, and then vote on the nominations. Is that acceptable to everybody? Okay, great. So I'd like to ask for a nomination for a school board member to serve as the trustee to New Horizons Board. Do I have any nominations?
Madam Chairman, could I nominate Jim Kelly to be my replacement on the New Horizon Regional Education Center?
Any other nominations? I have a motion to close nominations.
So moved.
Sirza, can you call the roll? To close nominations by signifying.
Close nominations would be Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Thank you.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly has been nominated to represent this board on as a trustee on the New Horizons Board. Signify your support of that by saying aye. Ms. Sirza, if you could call the roll, I appreciate it.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Okay. Next up is 4.05, appointment of school board member to serve on the WHRO board. I'd like to ask for nominations for a school board member to serve on the WHRO board. Are there any nominations?
Madam Chairman, I would like to nominate Jim Beers to continue serving on the WHRO board.
Are there any other nominations? Anyone like to make a motion to close nominations?
So moved.
Okay, I'd like to take a vote on closing nominations.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mrs. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
If all of those in favor of Dr. Beers serving on the WHRO board representing this board for the calendar 2017 calendar year, please signify by saying aye. Ms. Sirza, if you'd call the roll, please.
Mrs. Taylor? Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Owenby.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Thank you. Next is item 4.06, appointments of school board members to committees. There are five committees to appoint to, and if it's okay with the board, what I'd like to do is ask for nominations and then vote on those nominations in the order that they're nominated, rather than going through the process of closing nominations for each vote. Is that okay with everybody? Great. All right. So the first one is 21st Century Career and Career Ready Advisory Committee. We need one member to serve on that board. I'd like to ask for nominations. Are there any? Taylor, do you have any nominations for? Any nominations for the 21st Century and Career Ready Advisory Committee?
Is it appropriate to nominate yourself?
It is.
Mrs. Chair, I'd like to nominate myself for that committee, please.
Madam Chair, I'd like to nominate Mrs. Owenby for that position.
Are there any other nominations? So the vote will be taken in the order that the nominations were made. And we need one member to serve on this committee. So the first is for Ms. Young. Ms. Serza, will you please call the roll? Please signify your support for Ms. Young by saying aye.
Ms. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Nay.
Mr. Kelly?
Nay.
Ms. Owenby?
Nay.
Mrs. Taylor?
Nay.
Ms. Cook?
Nay.
The next vote, please signify your support for Ms. Owenby serving on the 21st Century and Career Ready Advisory Committee for calendar year 2017. Please signify by saying aye. Could you call the roll, please?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Owenby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
No.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
The next committee appointment is Special Education Advisory Committee, affectionately known as SEAC. We need one member to serve on this committee. Can I please have nominations?
Madam Chair, I move Mrs. Owenby to serve on the SEAC committee.
Are there any other nominations? Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please?
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Sorry.
Ms. Owenby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
The next committee is the Student Advisory Committee. We need two members from this body to serve on that committee. And so we will vote on each member individually. So may I please have nominations? I need...
Madam Chair, I move to nominate Mrs. Taylor and Mrs. Owenby for the Student Advisory Committee.
Are there any other nominations? Thank you. We could start with the vote for Ms. Taylor to serve on the Student Advisory Committee for calendar year 2017. Please signify by saying aye. Could you call the roll, please, Ms. Serza?
Ms. Owenby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
And next, for Ms. Owenby to serve on the Student Advisory Committee for the calendar year 2017, please signify by saying aye. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Owenby?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
The next committee is the Policy Committee, which also requires two members. May I please have nominations?
Madam Chair, I move that Julie Hummel and Holly Taylor.
Nominations? Ms. Hummel was nominated first, so Sirza, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. And then Ms. Taylor to serve on the policy committee as well for the calendar year 2017.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. And the last, the final committee is the school liaison committee, which also requires two members to serve from this board. If I could have some nominations, please.
I would like to nominate Jim Kelly.
To the JCC.
This is to the school liaison committee with the James City County and the city. Any other nominations? We could consider Mr. Kelly's nomination first for the school liaison committee. Ms. Sirza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. And then Ms. Hummel was also nominated. If we could please call that roll.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Thank you all very much for your willingness to serve, and congratulations. Next is item 5.01, announcements and superintendent's report. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Happy New Year, everyone. As we enter January, we are also entering inclement weather season. In fact, forecasters are predicting possible snow later this week. I'd like to remind our families that school delays and or closure announcements are made as quickly as possible following an assessment of our buildings and the condition of local roads, including roads within neighbourhoods. Student and staff safety is number one priority for us when making the decision to delay or to close schools. I encourage all families to be sure that their child's school has up-to-date contact information on file. This information is uploaded to our telephone notification system so that we can alert families to any change in schedule. For more information about our inclement weather process and where we post notifications, please visit wjccschools.org and click on About WJCC and Emergency and Crisis Planning. In December, author and motivational speaker Mel Jones spoke to Lafayette High School's Men of Vision and Purpose, the MVP Club. Jones is the author of 90, excuse me, Building the Ultimate Empire, which is a book about self-improvement and developing good habits that last a lifetime. After his presentation, Mr. Jones spoke with individual members and signed copies of the book for each student. And finally, a calendar note on January 12th at 6:30, the WJCC Special Education Advisory Committee will meet. The meeting will be held at James City County Recreation Centre on Long Hill Road, and the public is invited to attend. Those are all of the announcements I have this evening, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Dr. Heron. Do any school board members have any announcements? I was just about to ask if Ms. Sirza had any speaker cards.
Just one.
6.01, citizens' comments. Ms. Hummel?
It is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. These speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their names for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. It is the board's interest and desire that all comments are heard and respected. Hence, citizens are asked not to engage in applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstrations during the presentations. Personnel matters are not considered in public meetings. Therefore, the board requests that all speakers refrain from making reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. Although the board does not respond to your comments are heard and appreciated. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes to make their presentation, and the board asks that you respect this time limitation. Also, please be reminded that no time may be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Thank you, Madam Chairman, and my directions are concluded.
Ms. Taylor?
Jay Everson, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Congratulations, Madam Vice Chair and Madam Parliamentarian. I wanted to talk about the issue of transparency. It's interesting that Ms. Hummel today brought up the issue about moving from the 21st to 28th, and the question became, you know, with the school board offices closed on that Friday, how would you get the packet for that following Tuesday? Well, it seems to me that it might be, you know, in the interest of having more public awareness of what's going on with the school board, that the Wednesday before a meeting, the packets be posted, complete with what you all get, so that people, not only can you be able to address the issues, having looked them over in advance, but also give the public the opportunity to also look them over in advance if there's anything that they would be of concern to them. Now, the county does this without any problem. Years ago, when I was on the Planning Commission, we used to get them on Friday afternoon for a Monday meeting, and it was difficult to read all the materials that we would get. It seems to me it would make sense for this board to do that in the interest of full transparency, because I got to tell you, part of the meeting, your last meeting aside, I was shocked that all seven of you turn around and look up here on the value engineering, because none of it was in the packet. And I said to myself, this is unbelievable. These people are being asked to make decisions. Third largest employer in Williamsburg, over $100 million budget. They're getting the information at the meeting? Really? I tell you, I was shocked. And I would encourage you to post all this agenda stuff, complete with all the materials, for the public on the Wednesday before. It solves your problem for Thanksgiving. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Everson. Are there any more speaker cards?
That's it for tonight.
The next item on the agenda is 7.01, the VSBA Code of Conduct for School Board Members. The Virginia School Boards Association, otherwise known as VSBA, created a code of conduct for school board members and encourages all board members to adopt it. So tonight we will be discussing it for consideration for adoption at our next meeting. Is there any discussion?
Yes. I just wanted to highlight number 9. There are 12 items on here. Yeah, but so number 9 says, I'll refrain from using the board position for personal or partisan gain and avoid any conflict or interest or the appearance of impropriety. So just wanted to discuss that publicly in the efforts of transparency. It seems to me when folks run for school board that they should not align themselves with a political party. That this very clearly states the Virginia School Board Association Code of Conduct says that we should conduct ourselves independent of any political party. And I know for a fact that there are folks in our community who are leaders in particular political parties who feel that they can influence school board decisions. And I think we just need to bear in mind that the Code of Conduct says that we will operate independently of any political party. Important to note.
Anybody else?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I mean, I'd like to echo Mrs. Owenby's comments on that. And it's not only will refrain from using their position for partisan gain, but also avoid the conflict of interest or the appearance of impropriety. So it's not just, you know, staying out of the partisan game in the school board, but also the appearance of that. And so I think that's an important distinction, that ethics, that part of the code of conduct. I mean, there's 12 line items here. All of them are very important, and I don't want to necessarily highlight one over the other, but just thought I would echo Mrs. Owenby's comments there.
Yeah, and so I guess since we're discussing this and we'll vote on it later, I would like to know, obviously this is kind of like a, it's a code of honor, you know, that you will do this. There really is no enforcement of this, but certainly I do have questions about activities of certain school board members and their political affiliations and how those parties feel like they can influence certain decisions, and I think our role as school board members is to make sure that we are making decisions that are right for WJCC and our students and our families and our teachers and our administrators and our staff, and that there's no political agenda, national or state, that's influencing those decisions. And so I do have pause, quite frankly, about some of the things that are going on in this community and on the school board. And so maybe we need to discuss that more in depth, or discuss what the follow-up is or what the ramifications are of not following this code of conduct.
So I think that, you know, again, the code of conduct is something that the VSBA encourages school board members to adopt. And I think the idea is for us to adopt it as a board and then sign it as a board. That's not a requirement, so it's something that, you know, people are not comfortable with. It's also, just as an aside, embedded in our SOP, our standard operating procedures, in its entirety, as another reminder that, you know, by design, school boards are nonpartisan, and that's intentional, and they work best, I think, if people honor that. But is everybody comfortable with putting this on the agenda for adoption at the next meeting?
And is everyone comfortable with following it? I guess it's the bigger question. That's the bigger question.
I guess that's all we vote on.
Yeah. I think the vote means you follow it. Anything else? That we'll move on to 7.02, appointment to Special Education Advisory Committee. And as a matter of background here, our policy used to prohibit us, the school board, from appointing members to our advisory committees mid-year, if you will. At the request of Dr. Beers, actually, Mrs. Young and I worked to edit that policy and accommodate appointments as, if appropriate, as interested citizens came forth. So that's what this item is. And assuming this board's consent, we would put it on the next agenda for the next meeting for consideration and potentially appointment. So any discussion?
I think it's great that the policy was amended. To grow, it needs membership, so I'm very excited to have a potential candidate.
It's always been a very challenging one to fill.
Yes.
SEAC.
Very qualified candidate, so looking forward to voting.
Anything else? So we'll move this forward to the next meeting agenda. Okay, the next item is 7.03, Program of Studies for 2017 and 2018. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. every 2 years we bring to you some revisions to the Program of Study, but because of some additional changes within the 2 years, we're bringing it back to you this year with some significant changes. And Ms. Parker, Coordinator of School Counseling Programs, is here to present all of those changes for your consideration this evening. Thank you, Ms. Parker.
Thank you. Good evening, Ms. Chairman and School Board members and Dr. Heron. Tonight's proposed revisions and updates assist our program and studies in becoming a very user-friendly and relevant tool to aid students and families in our community in considering which courses and programs and options offer the best foundation for achieving their goals. Our program of studies directly aligns with our strategic plan. And And some overall changes and updates to the entire program of studies includes some updated course codes to align with updated VDOE SCED crosswalk. This is the national classification for all courses, so if a student's to transfer from division to division or state to state, the course codes remain consistent. We also removed all technology icons from course descriptions. These were the mouse icons that we used to use to previously designate courses that met the technology diploma requirement. However, our economics and personal finance course meets all of the VDOE virtual course requirements, and all of our CTE courses meet our technology and CTE requirement for diplomas. We also updated the list of course offerings for New Horizons Career and Technical Education Center and New Horizons Governor's School for Science and Technology to reflect New Horizons' own updates. And we updated the school board member section to include Ms. Ombi, representing the Powhatan District. And we will also update to include the board appointments from this evening's meeting. As we move into the general information and terminology section, which begins on page 4 of your program of studies draft, many of these updates cover existing information that was just not previously included in an earlier version of the program of studies. We included an explanation of fees. We refer to fees throughout a number of our courses, and we really wanted to make our families and students aware of the different fee waiver opportunities, not just for our course descriptions, but also for our AP examinations, SATs, ACTs, and PSAT examinations. We included an explanation of withdrawing from a course to provide some details and clarity to the withdrawal process for students and families interested in pursuing this option. We revised the course selection, registration, and drop ad information to include updated language and clarify both processes. We updated the early graduation information to clarify the process and provide an action item for those pursuing early graduation. And we revised the repeating a class for strength to clarify that credit is applied evenly between both of the enrollments in a GPA calculation. Some overall changes to our middle school program, which begins on page 6. We updated the program description for 6th, 7th, and 8th grade to reflect year-long elective options. This expands our student choice while utilizing our existing staff and faculty. We removed U.S. History 1 and U.S. History 2 from the Virginia State Assessment Program section to reflect an update in SOL testing requirements. We have included a reference to VDOE-approved multi-division online providers. The VDOE has, We've updated the upper elementary and middle school math sequence section to identify Math 6 and Math 8 as opportunities for acceleration for our students, and also to inform families and students that the math acceleration test is timed. We updated honors English requirements to identify division reading assessments as the methods of determining reading level. We revised the section title, Middle School Credit-Bearing Courses, to read High School Credit-Bearing Courses Taken in Middle School for clarification and some consistency purposes. And we updated language referring to the expungement timeline to specify that the August 1st deadline refers to the August 1st in which the same year that the course was taken in middle school for high school credit. We also combined information about expungement failures and courses dropped at middle school into one section and deleted the standalone section titled Failures and Courses Dropped at Middle School. Starting on page 22, some overall changes and updates to the high school program section. We included the notation meets virtual course requirement under economics and personal finance in the table of diploma requirements. This course meets the VDOE virtual course requirement. We wanted to make sure families were aware of that when planning. We replace the term technology with career and technical education in the table of diploma requirements to reflect an update in VDOE terminology. And we also included the notation industry credentials available to guide students and families towards courses that meet the VDOE graduation requirements. We included a reference to VDOE approval of WJCC's graduation requirements to proactively address any variations between diploma requirements. And we included information about standard credit accommodations for students with disabilities. This takes place of the previously phased out Virginia Modified Diploma. We added a requirement for all students to receive training in CPR, first aid, and AED, beginning with this year's freshman class. This also meets the Virginia Department of Education graduation requirement for both the standard and the advanced studies diploma. And this will actually be folded into our health and PE1 curriculum at high school. We removed the table of weighted courses and included a single statement that clearly identifies the types of courses that will receive a weight. We apply weight to all of our AP courses taken in a variety of different settings, along with courses taken at the Governor's School of Science and Technology and concurrent college courses. So rather, this list is continuously evolving and growing, and we just want to make sure our families and students have the most up-to-date information. We also removed the table of virtual Virginia courses and included an active link for additional information and up-to-date information about the virtual Virginia program. Since the last program of studies was printed last year, virtual Virginia went from offering 32 to 69 courses and continues to rapidly evolve. So again, we really want to make sure our families and students have access to the most up-to-date information. And we removed the table of dual enrollment courses. Likewise, this continues to evolve as opportunities change and arise, and we want to make sure everyone has up-to-date information. We expanded the definition of concurrent college enrollment to provide some additional details about this opportunity for our students and our families. We replaced the term e-learning with virtual learning to reflect an update in terminology. And we added the WJCC virtual learning program description as well. And then we included reference to the Virginia Department of Ed approved multi-division online providers. So VDOE has vetted and approved some specific online courses and programs outside of our own virtual learning program and Virtual Virginia. And students are able to transfer their grade and their credit in to WJCC upon course completion. Moving on to some changes and updates in specialty programs, beginning on page 30. We added early college program with Thomas Nelson Community College description so that students can proactively begin planning for this opportunity. Last year, we had 14 students who took advantage of this opportunity. This grew this year to 38 students and continues to expand and grow. We added Governor's Early College Scholar program description. This is a different program opportunity. Last year, we had 208 students participate. This year, we have 238 students, and again, continue to grow and expand this opportunity. We updated English as a second language description to align with new regulations set forth by the Every Student Succeeds Act. And we added the description of the Pathways Project, and then included program focuses at all three of our high schools. We also included an explanation of work-based learning. On average, we have about 20 kids per school per year participate in the work-based learning method of instruction. So we wanted to make sure that students were aware that that is an opportunity here at WJCC. We also updated the York County School of Arts contact information and identified some action items for interested students and families. And we made some updates to our core course planning guide to mirror our high school course offering selection that we will walk through in detail in just a moment through the program of studies. Additionally, we went ahead and transferred asterisks from English 11 and Honors English 11 to English 10 and Honors English 10 to reflect updated SOL test requirements.
So that concludes the overall updates and revisions. Now we can talk about some specific updates to course offerings and descriptions at both middle and high school. This begins on page 11. In regards to middle school, we updated the description of General Music Grade 6, Exploration of Theater Arts, and Art 6 to reflect that these courses may be offered in an exploratory wheel format to help us expand student choice while also utilizing existing staff. We removed all descriptions of the semester-based courses. All of these courses will still be offered in the year-long every other day format. We combine Guitar 1 and Guitar 2 into Guitar. This course will run as 1 year-long course versus 2 semester-based courses. And we combined Introduction to Acting and Intermediate Acting into Theater Art 7. This course will also run year-long every other day versus semester-based. In math, we added the Algebra 1 Sequence 1 description to reflect the Algebra 1 for 8th grade initiative. It's our local initiative that aligns with national trends. We adjusted the recommended grade levels to match the updated math sequence. In world language, Latin for World Power was changed to Introduction to World Languages. This was to expand our students' exposure to 2 or more languages throughout the entire year. And we replaced Part A and Part B with Sequence 1 and Sequence 2 in all of our World Language Level 1 2-year courses to reflect VDOE change in terminology. We also updated Latin 1 Sequence 1 and Sequence 2 course descriptions to reflect current course curriculum updates. And in CTE, we updated the description of Introduction to Technology to reflect that this course may be offered in an exploratory wheel format as well. In high school, beginning on page 36, we updated course names in Social Studies, Science, CTE, and Math to align with VDOE courses for 2017-2018, and they are all listed there for you. We have on the left the current course name and on the right what the replacement updated course name will be. We also updated course descriptions to align with curriculum updates and or VDOE requirements as well. In health and PE, we went ahead and included the training for emergency first aid, CPR, and AED to our health and PE 1 description. Successful completion of this course meets the VDOE graduation requirement. We added the notation industry credential available to our advanced physical conditioning course and lifetime fitness and conditioning course. This reflects the addition of a certified personal trainer exam and credential that will now be made available through these courses. In math, while the course will remain active, Fundamentals of Math course description was removed, and this was to clarify the course admittance process. Students do not select this course through our course selection process. Rather, they're placed into this course as a result of their Math 8 SOL or math performance, and so we didn't want folks to think that this was something that they would select during the course request process. In world language, we updated course descriptions in German, Latin, and Spanish to align with course curriculum updates. And in CTE, we included the notation industry credential available next to all of our CTE courses that offer Board of Education approved industry certifications and credentials. We also removed cooperative business education as a standalone course to clarify that this course number is only used in combination with a CTE course when the work-based learning method of instruction is employed. We removed Introduction to Early Childhood Education Services due to this course now being offered through New Horizons. Oh, I'm sorry.
What page are you on?
That was page 68.
Thank you.
So that was the removal of the Introduction to Early Childhood Education Services. And then moving to page 44, We included advanced orchestra course description to align with existing VDOE SOL sequences. And then in math, on page 48, we added the Algebra 1 Sequence 2 course description to also reflect the Algebra 1 for 8th grade initiative. In world languages, beginning on page 59, we added American Sign Language 4 course description. This course is offered annually, and though it tends to have a small course request, it's consistent. So typically, the American Sign Language 4 students are in the same class as American Sign Language 3. However, their curriculum's differentiated so that they can then receive a credit for both. We added computer science applications course description to the Project Lead the Way computer science strand. This will now be the second course in a two-course strand, the first being software engineering.
What page are you on?
That is on page 74.
It just would help, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
And then overall, the proposed courses to be removed, we propose to remove American Studies, both the English and the Social Studies portion of American Studies. This course runs in two parts, and they're currently taught together. Students are taking Advanced American Studies English and Advanced American Social Studies, and we have not had enrollment in the American Studies courses for the past 3 years. And that's on page 37. And we also removed computer science due to low enrollment. Students are taking our advanced placement computer science course in its place. And again, this course has not received any enrollment for the past 3 years. And some important upcoming dates regarding the student course selection process. February 1st begins our individual student planning sessions when school counselors meet one-on-one with students grades 7 through 12, or 7 through 11, rather, and meet with them and their families for their individual student planning sessions. February 13th begins our parent information sessions and curriculum fairs at all three of our middle schools and all three of our high schools. February 17th, our course request window opens for rising 9th through 12th grade students. And February 25th, our course request window opens for rising 6th through 8th grade students. And those are our proposed recommendations, changes, and updates for the 2017-2018 Program of Studies.
Any discussion? The PowerPoint I have is longer than this. It talks about virtual learning and.
Those are some supplemental slides in case there are any questions about our enrollment numbers on virtual learning programs or virtual
sure. Thank you. Okay. Any discussion?
Well, I have a handful of questions, so I hope that they're not too picky. I guess
no.
I have several
Great.
Questions, so tell me if they get too picune. So I was curious about the advanced art option at the middle school level for 8th grade. So the language that goes around that identifies that the student who would be eligible for this class is ready for high school level art, but it's not a high school credit-bearing course. But I wondered if that would serve to meet the Art Foundation's prerequisite at the high school level?
In previous years, that was the case, but because of the seat time requirement of that course, that no longer met the Foundation of Art requirement in 8th grade.
So this just really gives those 8th grade students who love art and are really good just a more in-depth opportunity.
Absolutely.
Okay. If I can, I have like a handful, I'm sorry.
No, it's great.
So was just wanted to touch base about the applied diploma for children with IEPs and special needs that replaces the former, I guess, the modified diploma. Mm-hmm. So When a child graduates with that diploma, what can they do with that diploma?
Excellent question. It is not actually a separate diploma. It is still the standard diploma, just like every other student receives standard diplomas. The difference is that they've received credit accommodations in order to earn the standard and verified credits needed to earn the standard diploma. So the diploma itself is a state standard, is a WJCC standard diploma. So they just utilize different credit accommodations in order to get there.
Okay, so they can go to Thomas Nelson.
Absolutely.
And enroll in their post-secondary option or whatever
yes.
that is. Okay,
yes.
That's phenomenal. And then with regard to the new specialty program that's in conjunction with Thomas Nelson Community College, which I think is phenomenal, exciting, and it's just yay. Are we going to cap the number of students? Because there were 14 last year and 38 this year. I know Ms. DePaul and I spoke about this, but I'm just curious, do we just kind of wait and see how many people enroll, or do we have to cap it at the onset?
There's currently been a lot of interest. Currently, the program is running at Warhol High School, but I know there's been a lot of interest at Jamestown and Lafayette as well to expand the program at all three schools. The program caps itself just given the criteria and requirements in order to be a part of the program, but that's absolutely something we can discuss.
Okay, so I just wondered if there is going to be a cap, can that language be included in the program of studies? Because it's not, and so I just wanted parents and students to know, you know, if we are going to cap it, that, you know, be the first one to apply or whatever. Like,
no, that's great. Yes.
Okay, so we can include that.
As a follow along with that, just sure. another question. So it's just currently available to Warhol students only?
Currently this year, mm-hmm. The early college program is available at Warhol students, Warhol High School students.
Is that next year it changes?
Next year it's expanding to Jamestown and Lafayette.
Okay, so this is for
students planning for next year.
Next year, mm-hmm. Great, okay.
Yeah. So, and then kind of along the lines, Julie, you probably were thinking that way too. So with the project Lead the Way, again, the language that's in the program of studies says that this is an option for Warhol students at this time. So I would like that language to say, this is available for all WJCC students. So is that something that we envision, that Project Lead the Way, which is distinctly and uniquely different in terms of course offerings, is that something that would be available to Lafayette and Jamestown students as well?
It's my understanding that for the 2017-2018 academic year, that those Project Lead the Way courses would be available to students currently enrolled at Warhol High School.
Okay.
If that is the case, then I think the wording needs to actually say only Warhol students.
Yes.
Because right now, it's not.
It isn't.
Very
we did tweak
clear.
The wording a little bit to specifically state students
right.
enrolled at Warhol High School.
Right. Well,
mm-hmm.
It
was a little
different.
Does it say
that, or does it say?
It doesn't say only, and it probably
should.
It doesn't
say only, and I think it needs to.
But then the bigger question that it begs is, why does it have to say only, and how long does it have to say only?
For Project Lead the Way for yeah. Warhol High School.
Because with the innovation grants, we're now allowing students, quite frankly, to move around from high school to high school based on the program of studies. So I don't see why that's any different than the two new innovation grants that are going to come online in the fall at Lafayette and Jamestown.
Dr.
So why does that one continue to stay uniquely Warhol?
I think it takes a period of time to develop a program like Project Lead the Way, and it involves training teachers to teach the specific courses involved in Project Lead the Way. At the moment, other schools haven't expressed an interest in starting that specific program because they're focused on their high school innovation project
no, I get that.
At this
I'm
moment
sorry to
in
interrupt.
Time.
But why couldn't students choose to go to Warhol?
Exactly.
Just
exactly.
like now they can choose
yes.
to go there through Pathways, why couldn't they choose to go there for Project Lead the Way?
Or like they can well, go
students can
way.
Currently choose to enroll at Warhol High School. If
or
they're
Project
interested
Lead the Way?
In attending Project Lead the Way courses.
Mm-hmm. We need to make
but they
that
would
clear.
Have to fully enroll at Warhol High
we
School.
We need to make that clear yes. then, so that if your child wants this option, that you can, in fact, because that's not the information that's on the street right now.
Okay.
We can certainly make sure that that's clearer. And, of course, there's only a certain number of students that can take part in a program like this.
Because it's capped.
Absolutely.
So that needs to be in the program of study, so people have a full understanding of the accessibility and the caps and the limits, but that it is open. It is open to the entire division.
Or the process that they need to go through in order to try to appeal to get into the program.
Okay.
I think that's really, I feel really strongly that it's a wonderful, wonderful program offering excellent opportunities for our students, and it shouldn't be limited just to
Warhol.
People who are zoned to Warhol.
We'll certainly look into see what's possible in terms of enrollment and look at the language in the program of studies as well.
Okay, that's great. I have a couple more. I'm sorry.
Yeah, please.
So then the School of Arts at York County, that's mm-hmm. another exciting option for our students. Is there a fee associated with that if our students choose to participate in that program?
There is a fee associated with that. Currently, we have one student division-wide who's participating in that program.
So when I read that option, I don't recall, but it was late at night last night when I read it. But I don't recall at any notation about a fee being associated with that. So could we just include that language, even if it's vague, so that people understand that?
I have included in there, folks, a direct action item for them to contact, because I know that changes every year, and I want to make sure they're contacting Bruton High School and the actual program to get that updated information.
Okay, cool. I'm almost done. With the fitness, the lifetime fitness, which yes. we now have a certification, that's great. I think having our students have access to as many certifications yes. as possible is phenomenal. However, the language that's in the program of studies notes that it's available, that certification is available at some high schools.
Why? That's correct.
Why not all the high schools?
In order to be able to offer that, the actual teachers have to be certified in order to be able to offer that course. And this is something that's new for next year. So similar to what Dr. Heron said, it's a rollout.
Okay, so we'll eventually get that.
The idea is to offer as many certifications as we possibly can to all students,
but it
always starts somewhere.
Okay.
It's the same as the early college program. It started at Warhill. It was a partnership that Dr. Carroll negotiated with the community college, and now we're expanding it to Jamestown and Lafayette High School next year.
That's
and they're
great.
Very excited about the opportunity for their students.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's phenomenal. That's great. Okay. And then with regard to the early childhood course, which currently I think is only at Lafayette, and Julie and I both flagged it.
We are just on the same page.
I know. So it gives me pause, because isn't that associated with CDR and the 900 building and CDR working with our students to have the hands-on lab opportunities? Is that not the course
that's not my understanding.
So is that the parenting course? Because there are two kind of similar courses in the
program
studies.
They're different courses. The parenting courses continues. Mm-hmm. And that course specifically, we have not had enrollment in that specific course. And it is offered through New Horizons CTEC.
The one
in the early childhood program.
Is that the 8231?
On page 68.
On page 68.
So right now, which is the course that is tied to CDR?
I'll find that out for you. Absolutely. It's a great question.
We need clarification on that one.
Okay.
Because it's my understanding that CDRs opens up their doors so that our students who are taking that course can then come in and kind of have the hands-on experience, which is why they're in the 900 building. So
I looked into some of that, and it would be nice to get clarification mm-hmm. for what's happening next year.
Absolutely.
Because the general feeling that I got was that there were some classes, and occasionally students would come in and help out, but that it wasn't like a specific class that was tied to CDR.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what I would like clarification for the program of study starting in 2017-2018, exactly academically what is going on with any students that are taking classes at Lafayette, and exactly what are they doing with CDR.
Right. Yeah, because my understanding is the opposite. My understanding is that those two courses, the one that you're eliminating, and then there's another one that's like two below it, like parenting or something. I'm not looking at it. It's parenting. It's called parenting. There you go. That one. That one and the one that you're eliminating are the ones that our students take, and then they have hands-on opportunities with CDR's early childhood program. So I want clarification as well. So we just need to flesh that out. And before we eliminate that, so
we'll certainly look into it and provide clarification for the board before the next meeting so that you've got all the information you need.
And if there hasn't been any enrollment in parenting, like I guess you're removing certain other classes that haven't had any enrollment for several years, should that not also be one? If it's being taught at New Horizons, does it need to be taught at Lafayette?
Well, the introduction to early childhood education and services, that is the course that falls under the early childhood program for New Horizons. However, I'll have to look into the parenting to see if that also falls under the program.
Okay, and then I'm on my last question, really. Thank you. Thank you for...
Yeah.
So with regard to language, at the high school level, so I know that historically... not all languages were available at all of the schools. It was just based on enrollment. So will that continue to be the trend? So say you're at Lafayette and you want German and it's not at German, then you would go to Jamestown because Jamestown has it? Like, is that it will still operate in that way? Not all the languages are offered at all
the high schools. Our course offerings are based strictly on our course requests. So it's based on student demand for a certain course in order for the course to run. So that's really just going to depend on student course requests through the selection process and how many students request that specific world language course.
Okay. Thank you. I'm finally done.
Thank you.
Taylor, do you have any questions? Or are you... All right, Julie, Samuel.
I have one.
A couple months ago, Stephen Staples had a presentation that was at Lafayette High School about education. And there was a math teacher that stood up and talked about what happens to students if they can't pass, I think it was it algebra in middle school, and then that they go on to high school and they can't retake a class that's offered in middle school, and so they are continually falling behind. Do you remember?
That's not the case at WJCC.
Okay, because I didn't.
Students who would not pass Algebra 1 still have the option to repeat the class when they get to high school.
Then they get to, great. Okay.
And our current students going into next year will have the opportunity to take Algebra 1 Sequence 1 in middle school and then Algebra 1 Sequence 2 in high school as well.
Great. Okay. Thanks for clarifying that because I was worried about that.
Julie, just to add on that to clarify too. So when a student takes a high school level class in middle school and if they fail it or don't like the grade, they can expunge it.
Absolutely.
With no dent to the GPA. However, if they take the high school level class in high school and they don't like the grade, they can retake it, but then both grades are recalculated together into the GPA.
Correct. That's a Virginia Department of Education standards of accreditation.
Right. Mm-hmm. Just to make that, yes, that is a distinction between taking it at the middle school level and taking it at
it
the
is.
High school level.
Mm-hmm.
And then one other question about the Thomas Nelson. Are those weighted classes?
Which courses are you referring to?
Like the specialty program?
Specialty programs?
A new specialty program.
It depends on the courses and which a student chooses to take.
Okay.
It really depends on the courses a student chooses to take. And in regards to the weight, a student's GPA calculation, if they're part of that specific early college program through TNCC, their GPA calculation stops at that mid-semester because once the spring semester comes, they don't attend our on-site campus at all. They are full-time Thomas Nelson Community College students. And so for college applications and such, they receive two transcripts, one from us as well as one from TNCC.
Mm-hmm. And then for students that are taking college level classes, let's say William and Mary, that are weighted, mm-hmm. They can only take those classes if they're not offered at WJCC, correct? So for example, if there's a class in photography offered, they can't take a class in photography at William & Mary and get a weighted grade if there's a class that's offered at WJCC.
I think that would be a case-by-case individual course decision. It would be a determination. We, in regards to our concurrent college courses, the criteria is that the course would not be an introductory-level course. And so that would be something we'd have to look at, the course code, and see if it's an introductory-level course or if it's something above that. So I think that would be a course-by-course decision.
Just for some clarification, students that take courses at colleges are normally above and beyond the offerings of what we have at WJCC. And as Ms. Parker said, the weighted has to be past the introductory stage. So they can take a course in photography. If they've taken photography with us, they can take an advanced photography course at William & Mary, but they wouldn't take an intro course at William & Mary as a substitute for what we offer.
In order to get weighted.
Correct.
Correct.
Okay, thanks. And that's somewhere in here? Is that
it's under the criteria
somewhere?
For King College
I mean, but that policy is somewhere in here.
We'll double check and make sure it is.
Thank you.
Anything else, Mrs. Hummel?
Yeah, I just had a question about the American Studies program. You said that that had been removed because the students were taking the advanced and honors class.
Advanced American Studies?
Can you clarify? So what happens to the students that aren't in the advanced program? Are they all in the advanced studies program?
There is not an advanced studies program. It's not an advanced placement course or a gifted course. Any student can take advanced American studies.
Okay, but I guess my question is, I'm looking at the wrong, is this for grades 9 and 10?
For American studies?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. For English and Dr. Minnelli, 11.
Okay, grade
11. 11th grade.
So students that are not in that class, then what happens? They're not required to take American Studies, or they have an option to take other classes? I'm just trying to...
Yeah, absolutely. It's a good question. I'm sorry, Dr. Dr. Lynn can speak to that content specifically.
Good evening. They'll take either Advanced American Studies or English 11. So they either go to English 11 or they go to Advanced American Studies.
Because Advanced American Studies includes English and...
The enhanced writing of the American Studies, exactly. So either you can take the advanced piece of it, and if you don't want to take the advanced, you'll take Gen Ed English 11.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to figure out. Thank you.
You're welcome.
That answered my question.
Mr. Kelly.
A couple of quick questions. Sure. So I noticed every student has to take CPR first aid. That's a General Assembly requirement.
Yes.
Do they fund
Virginia Department of Education. We are folding that into our health and PE1 curriculum, and they have to be exposed to the curriculum or receive the training.
So they have to be exposed, but they don't have to necessarily be certified?
Nope. They don't have to be certified. They just have to receive the training.
Okay, and it's done as part of our health and PE credit? And,
yes.
Okay. I also saw in the program of studies about the class rank. Now, I don't think everybody should get a trophy, and I know there's a first and there's a last, but is class rank really useful in today's world? I know there's some talk about getting rid of it some places. I know that there seems to be some negative to a class rank, that it hurts our students applying to colleges versus helps our students applying. Thoughts on that?
On class rank?
Yes.
I think discussion of class rank is a large discussion that's evidence and research-based, and I know there's a lot of different research that addresses that specifically. So I'm happy to look into that further.
Dr. Heron, do you want to?
We can certainly gather some of the research if the board's interested and provide a very quick executive summary on the pros and cons of that, if that would be of interest to the board.
Yeah, I don't know about the board, but I know it would be interest of me, because I know that the class rank is, some systems have gotten away from it, and I just want to kind of think about that.
Absolutely.
Is that okay? So in this agenda item, there is a cost associated with it attached to the copies that need to be printed. I'm assuming that's a budgeted cost.
Yes.
Okay. Can you speak a little bit about the timeline that you presented to us? We've tasked you all with some clarification, points of clarification, but can you help us understand what we need to do as a board so that you can move on with your timeline in terms of when we need to take action on this?
We'll be bringing it back for your approval at the next board meeting to keep in line with the timeline to serve our students and give them access to choice. That will mean that it's on us to get us the clarification on all of the questions that you've asked this evening to enable you to do that at the next board meeting.
Okay.
So we'll make it a priority to respond to those specific questions about the program of studies immediately.
Thank you very much. One of the questions I had about the changes in middle school were switching, it appears to be switching away from semester classes to year-long classes, which I'm a little concerned may take away opportunities for students to explore.
Mm-hmm.
Can you help me understand what the logic was behind that and what?
Absolutely. Well, First and foremost, we were running year-long and semester-based options, and we are going to continue running the year-long courses on A-B days, which they're currently running. So they run every other day, and so that gives students opportunity to take more than one per period because they run every other day. So offering consistent year-long course options reduces the vast number of configurations that can occur as a result of those semester singleton courses. And as a result, this increases our staff availability to run additional sections of course offerings, which increases our students' opportunity to receive the courses in which they are requesting. So our projection for next year is an increase from 70 students, or 70% of students currently receiving their first choice electives, to over 95% of students who will be receiving their first choice course elective by the switch from semester-based to year-long every other day.
So you predict that?
Yes, that based on the numbers and the trends that we've seen for the past 3 years.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was going to ask about the unfunded mandate for CPR. Yeah, that's good. If memory serves, you recently switched to online registration for courses, and you anticipated seeing some changes as a result of that. Your statement that that course offerings are driven by student demand made me think of that. I'm curious. I know it's early. But I'm curious if you've seen or observed any changes or anything after year one of doing that in regard to student demand. And because sometimes there maybe something wasn't popular at one school, mm-hmm. and so did this change that or
I can certainly look into that for you.
Okay. But no observations off the top of your. You don't have to look into it. I'm just as curious if anything struck you.
None have struck me, but since I've been here, we've been doing the online course request. We haven't been doing the by-hand course request, but I can certainly look into that.
Just curious if you saw any changes.
Ms. Cook, I think one of the key things that happened, it's much more efficient. We get the choices in the system. We get parent input as well, and then we're able to schedule much more quickly. So I think it's very much an efficiency piece that has really helped us as a system.
And I think that's it. Does anyone else have any other questions? Oh, thank you very much for taking the time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dr. Heron, do you have anything to add?
No. Thank you.
Okay. That brings us to agenda item 8.01, Equity Through Engagement, Title I Literacy Support Initiatives. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We're delighted this evening to bring you yet another part of our series of Equity Through Engagement. And this evening we're going to focus on research-based approaches to narrowing and eliminating performance gaps in primary literacy. And Ms. Laura Burton, coordinator of Title I, will be presenting the information this evening. Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board, Dr. Heron. I am pleased to share some of the methods that Title I is using to achieve equity through engagement with you all tonight. Everything that I'm going to share with you is above and beyond the work of the regular classroom teachers and the reading specialists as well. Title I schools receive additional funding and provide extra support services in early literacy at the kindergarten through third grade range to help close achievement gaps. Today's highlights on Title I include who we serve, a review of newly added Title I services that are grounded in effective research-based practice, through the use of leveled literacy intervention systems and successful start intervention in kindergarten. I will close with a short featured story and a summary of the highlights about our offerings in Title I. So who does Title I serve? In WJCC, 7 of the 9 elementary schools receive Title I funding. Once a school qualifies for Title I funding, all students in grades kindergarten through second with academic need are eligible for services. Title I schools include Clara Bird Baker, J. Blaine Blayton, Rawls Bird, James River, DJ Montague, Norge, and Matthew Whaley. And newly added this year, we are expanding to include support for grade 3 in this second semester. You may wonder why Title I has implemented new approaches in WJCC. Historically, WJCC has focused the use of funding in first grade only. But with increases in funding over time, we were able to expand our services to include kindergarten, second, and third grades. As an example of funding levels, back in 2003, when WJCC was at 17% free and reduced lunch for economically disadvantaged students, we received just under $900,000. Currently, we have 33% free and reduced lunch need. Due to the increase in that need this year, Title I was awarded just over $1.4 million for supplemental academic services. And all of these funds are used to provide additional services and instructional opportunities above those given in the regular classroom. Thus, the added support we provide is now reflected in the two new approaches I'm going to share with you tonight. I'd like to start by showing you a brief clip of what leveled literacy intervention looks like in action.
Watched from a distance, do you see? What do you think Fox might be thinking?
He
might go get it, yes.
He might want to get
it. And if he's watching from a distance, does that mean he's close or far away?
All right. He was right.
It was a good prediction, wasn't it? All right. So now we're going to turn back to the beginning, and we're going to read to find out what happens. All right? Remember, you're looking for those parts to help you when you're reading, okay?
Can we say worked?
Yeah, we can. That's okay. Okay, we can use those endings with that word, can't we?
Okay.
We're going to use the word, let's say start. Start. Isn't that part that you know? Star. Do you know where that has that sound in it? R.
He starts
playing every morning. Yeah, it does. There you go. I like the way you work that out.
I hear you saying it. Say more. That part's er. Early
one, spring morning, one.
You notice something good? Go back. Start here.
Does.
Saddle fox. The.
All right. So what you have just seen are teachers using the new instructional routines through the leveled literacy intervention system. A whole host of new tutors and teachers were trained last spring along with other Title I teachers. This training helps teachers and tutors develop their teaching of reading skills to get students actively engaged with a set of high-quality leveled text for accelerated learning opportunities. We piloted leveled literacy intervention in the spring of 2016, and in just 2 short months, we had 190 students out of 312, or 61%, were on grade level by the end of the year. This year, we are fully implemented from kindergarten through second grade, and we expect greater outcomes with offering it for the full year. Additionally, we are expanding to grade 3 this semester. Again, these services are in addition to the regular reading instruction in the classroom. Similarly to the leveled literacy intervention system, Successful Start also uses small groups of 3 students for lessons that consist of reading to children, reading with children, and writing with children in kindergarten. In this model, professional development is the key to Successful Start, as kindergarten teachers are trained alongside Title I staff to ensure continuous support and best practice in reading instruction. DJ Montague and J. Blaine Blayton are in their initial year of Successful Start. These two schools were identified through a needs assessment process that featured the level of openness and readiness for change in overall literacy practice. As part of the training, kindergarten teachers started literacy instruction from the very beginning of the school year and report amazing progress by students, with current levels trending for students at a level that is normally expected at the end of year already, at this time of year. This will expand equitable performance levels for more students from the early years, leaving other services in Title I to address more intense needs for some students that need it. In addition to noticeable outcomes, parents and student responses are positive. Here is an example of a note from a mother of a 5-year-old in a kindergarten classroom who wanted to add his mark on his mother's note. The note states, "Thank you, Mrs. Reams. I'm so thrilled with Trent's progress in reading. I had to give him extra praise for reading his book like he talks. It helped that we have a Yorkie, too. P.S. He wanted to write you a note like me and used what you taught him for figuring out words. He discovered how to spell book because it rhymes with look. An awesome teachable moment." Trent added, "Thank you, Mrs. Reams. I like this book." This is just one example of the great opportunity of our kindergartners experiencing through the additional Title I opportunity this year. So as we come to a close tonight, it is helpful to highlight how our WJCC Title I services align nicely with what research says about key factors in success. Both of these approaches you heard about tonight, along with our ongoing use of reading recovery, a one-to-one method of instruction, matches readers to the right level of text. It increases the volume of reading to provide massive amounts of experience and opportunities, offers small group instruction, coordinates with regular classroom teachers, teaches students to think about text, and helps provide training for expert instruction. The last component on having expert teachers is very important because Title I, for the first time, is doing more to coordinate training and services that students benefit from alignment between the classroom instruction and supplemental services to accelerate the learning and truly close achievement gaps in the early grades. We look forward to updating you on the outcomes in the future. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have a couple questions. Thanks for this presentation, by the way. What is the threshold that a school has to have in free and reduced lunch percentages in order to qualify as a Title I school?
Great question. We currently have a division average of 33% free and reduced lunch. And so any school that is at or above 33% at the elementary range is eligible for services. And we currently serve all 7 of the 9 elementary schools that are eligible with the funds we currently have.
So 7 of our schools are at 33% free and reduced lunch.
That's correct.
Elementary schools.
Of the elementary schools.
Yes.
And then what happens to some of the students that are free and reduced lunch kids that go to the schools that don't qualify for being Title I? How do they get the services that they need?
That's a great question. So we do have local funding that is available across the division, and those services are provided at all schools. So there's reading specialists at all buildings, student support teachers at all buildings, and a variety of other supplemental services that are provided across the board. What Title I does is offer services that are above and beyond what the division does at the board level across the whole division. So they have opportunities that really are similar, if not the same, but we offer more at the schools that have the greatest need.
Just for clarification, this particular program that you highlighted this year, it's at Blayton and DJ?
Correct.
Okay. And then with every year, we'll continue to add on more of this of the 7 so that eventually all of the 7 will have this new
additional supplemental program?
That's a great question, actually. It really will be based on funding, I think interest by schools, and really using the needs assessment of the staff for an openness and a readiness to do an overall literacy change at the kindergarten level. And so we will evaluate that each year with program outcomes and results and interest and needs assessments and funding, of course.
So, and that changes every year based on our overall free and reduced lunch percentage, correct? So each year they look at our average number, like right now it's 33%. And so if that goes up or down.
Correct. I mean, it has stayed relatively similar for the last few years, in the 30s, like 31, 32, 33. So we've just sort of gone up by a small percentage in the last couple of years. So the funding has been pretty level. What would we call
it? Mrs. Ohm, if I could clarify, the second program that Ms. Burton talked about is offered, is being piloted at two schools, but right. The level literacy, all seven schools are receiving the tutors who've been trained in level literacy.
And that's the reading recovery. So like
that's actually in addition to reading recovery. It's a separate program we've introduced in the last year.
Right, could but you reading explain recovery the is difference? At all seven, right? Reading
is in all nine.
All nine. Okay.
The division supports it in non-title schools. We supplement that and add resources to title schools.
Okay, so there's reading recovery, and then there's leveled literacy.
And
two different?
And that's just at two right now.
That's just at two, okay.
Level literacy is in seven out of nine.
Oh, correct.
Seven. All Title I schools.
So then what's just in DJ and Blayton?
Just successful start for kindergarten.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Successful start.
Yes. Again, we're taking another piece of the puzzle at the earliest stage to impact students and give them access to reading. And it's beginning to show results already, and we will certainly look at funding when we look at the data, which will drive our decision moving forward.
Are the teachers that are teaching reading recovery and leveled literacy the same teachers? Are they the same people? Or is it a different group of people?
In some cases, yes. There are Title I teachers that do both reading recovery. They're certified. They must be certified and maintain that certification for reading recovery. But we've also provided training for all of the Title I teachers in leveled literacy intervention. But in addition to that, we have tutors. We have a whole host of tutors, most of which are wonderful retired reading specialists and classroom teachers from the division who come back and work part-time for us. And they are the ones that supplement the Title I teachers, the full-time teachers, use of level literacy intervention. So that's why we were able to basically double the number of students that we've served in the last few years. We've been hovering around 250. Our goal was to get up to 300. We added tutors a couple years ago, and now we're at 618 with the use of the additional funds for our increases in free and reduced lunch, and we've been able to do that through the use of tutors as well.
And those tutors have been very specifically trained in the program. We just haven't hired and put people with students. We've actually trained them what to do, and that's why it's having an impact on the ability of students to read, which is exciting.
Mr. Kelly?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Madam Chair. I think Mrs. Chair, Mr. Chair. Mrs. Burton, I appreciate you coming out tonight and giving us this presentation. Literacy services, particularly in the K-3, are vital for our students' long-term success, and it's important that we serve those students as well as we possibly can. Looking at the results that you show on the leveled literacy intervention results, how does that compare to those students that don't receive those services? Do we see a marked improvement in the students that receive the leveled literacy or over others? What would be the delta there that you expect the difference to be?
Well, what we found in the short period that we implemented this last spring with the 2 months was a very good response in the students that did participate. It's meant to be short term, like 18 to 20 weeks, or maybe a few more if students need longer. But from just the short amount of time where we were able to train all of the tutors in January and get materials and student services started in February, to have 190 students respond and be considered on grade level by the classroom teacher, actually not by us, a specialist. The classroom teacher had to do the assessment and say they met on grade level criteria based on the division reading. We found that to be very encouraging results. And we look forward to really expanding on those results as we implement across the whole school year.
So of the 312 students that were served, none of those were on grade level, then, and 190 read led after the 18 to 20 week program achieved grade level and as a, at the 61% rate.
Correct. Correct.
Gotcha. Perfect. Thank you.
Good. So following on Mr. Kelly's comments, I presume the other students made some gains. Or did you measure gains that, so maybe not at grade level, but some sort of measurable progress?
Well, our goal is to serve all the students that are in need in the Title I program. So our roles are really filled. I mean, we try to hire enough tutors and teachers to provide services to all of those in need. So really, when we're talking about Title I results, we're counting everyone. So there are no others for us, unless, for example, third grade is the newest grade that we're adding, and we're going to start by offering at least one to two tutors at each school. And so we may find there are more students in third grade who need support than we can offer initially this first semester out of the gate. But our goal is to always have enough tutors and classroom teacher or Title I teachers to cover the students that are in need.
So I don't think I worded my question well. Of the 312 students that received services over that short period, 190 reached grade level. So I assume the teachers love that. They're probably huge fans. But of the 120 that didn't, they did make progress, though. Measurable progress?
Correct. Correct. Many of them were very close to being on grade level. You know, some make more accelerated gains than others, and there are always some students who need additional time that don't make as much gains in a short amount of time.
Sure, yeah.
So we continue to support those students in an ongoing way across the grade levels. And across services. So, for example, some students may need one-on-one versus a small group, and so we always try to meet their needs if they have outlier results. Did that answer?
Yes, it did. Thank you very much. Any other questions? Anything to add, Dr. Heron?
Thank you very much. This is probably one of the most important things we can do as a school division is to say, have the goal of every single student reading on grade level by grade three. And these are some of the ways that we're beginning to do this and really make an impact within the last year.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good evening.
That takes us to action items. Agenda item 9.01, approval of minutes from the November 15th meeting and the December 13th meeting. May I have a motion, please?
Madam Chair, I move that we approve the meeting.
May I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please?
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Next item is action item 9.02, personnel actions. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve personnel actions as presented.
Second, please.
Second.
Discussion? Serza, will you call the roll, please?
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. And now we're at item 9.03, WJCC Schools Foundation donation for innovative learning grants. I'd like to ask Dr. Heron and Mrs. Hummel to discuss this, please.
Would you like a motion first?
Sure. Thank you very much for the reminder.
Chair, I move approval of the WJCC Schools Foundation donation for innovative learning grants in the amount of $30,138.68.
Mrs. Hummel, can I have a second, please?
Second.
Excellent. Now, Mrs. Hummel and Dr. Heron, would you like to introduce our guests?
Mr. Wilson, will you please come to the stage?
Good evening. Madam Chairperson, first of all, congratulations. Congratulations to the other elected members this evening. My name is Clarence Wilson. I'm president of the WJCC Schools Foundation Board of Directors. And I thank you for the opportunity to spend a moment with you. First of all, to affirm the presentation of the $30,138.68 grant to the school board, school division, for grants that will be delivered on January 17th of this month in our annual award celebration. I believe you all have your invitations, and we would love to see you at the celebration. These grants will fund 22 individual grants covering 31 teachers this year. And over the foundation's two-year history, this amounts to $57,400 that we have awarded to the school division. Also, over that same two-year period, some 64 school division staff members have received grants, and each year those grants will impact about 7,000, over 7,000 students, or more than 60% of the division student population. I believe we can all agree that in this case, a little money goes a long way. But we're just getting started and believe the resources provided by the foundation will be an important support in helping the school division achieve its goal of enhancing learning through innovative initiatives. Imagine the time when students are enjoying the benefits of having dozens of innovative ideas working in their classroom, all funded by the WJCC Schools Foundation. To meet this challenge, the board is focused on building capacity and sustainability in three primary areas. First, in the area of building a strong board with diverse skills, diverse approaches. Our board is a very committed and very hands-on, and that's out of necessity due to the limited staff support. But as a result, we depend on board members to have working skills in key areas such as development, marketing, finance, programs, and others. And it is critical that we continue to attract board members with a broad diversity of skills and approaches to problem solving who don't mind rolling up their sleeves and getting kind of down in the weeds, because that is what is required by the foundation to be successful. This focus is particularly important as we compete for board and committee talent in a community overflowing with nonprofits. We are pleased to have Dr. Heron and Mrs. Humble as members of our board, strong contributors to the board, and we look forward to their continued support. The second area that we are working on is donor cultivation. We have a goal of building a strong donor database, 1,500, 2,000 active contributing households, and we're making progress. We really want the community to own the work of the Education Foundation and support it because they believe in a strong public education system. To date, over 200 members of the community have donated to support the foundation, and fundraising in our second year was up significantly over the first year. Our best spokespersons have been grant winners. Donors have been absolutely impressed with what they have heard from the winners, grant winners, that they have been able to hear about their projects. They like the commitment, They like the ideas that are coming through in these projects. And our goal is to get as many of our donors in front of grant winners so that they can hear that story. That is the best fundraising event that we can ever have. So I thank Dr. Heron, and I thank the school division for helping us make that happen on a number of occasions this past year. And the third area we're focusing on is administrative ease. Our donor management system is run today on a spreadsheet. And Madam Chair, I know you know that's not sustainable, given your background. And it is also not linked with our financial system. But that's how you start up. And we recognize that when we did. But our goal this year is to transition to an online system fully connected to our financial system because we insist on full automation and efficient administrative systems. We don't see a time where we're going to have unlimited support. So we must prepare for an environment that allows us to operate with a minimum of support. And this is the area that we are really focused on. So we celebrate the foundation's success so far in providing resources to the school division to support innovation and believe we have identified the right building blocks to ensure the foundation's long-term capability to support innovation in our schools. On behalf of the foundation's board of directors, I thank the school board and the school division for your support and cooperation in helping the foundation to achieve its goals. Thank you.
Absolutely. All right. Where's he going?
Mr. Wilson, you're welcome to stay at the podium if you'd like to field any questions. You know, people may want to thank you. Is there any discussion? All right, any discussion?
I just want to say, as a member of the WJCC Foundation Board, it is always a pleasure to work with you and the rest of the board. It is just a great altruistic group of people who have very, very busy lives on their own, but they see this desire to bring joy to teachers and children, and it's just a feel-good foundation to be a part of. So thank you for the opportunity to serve, and thank you for all of what you do for not only the WJCC Foundation, but also, I understand, you're the outgoing...
Gone.
I will miss you in that capacity as well. Yeah.
So. Thank you.
Dr. Heron, would you like to
thank you,
that?
Madam Chair, Mr. Wilson, and Foundation Board. Just want to say a big thank you from the school system. You've done an incredible job over the last year in raising an incredible amount of funding for our teachers to give them an opportunity to do innovative things in the classroom. And I know one of the most exciting days of the year will be January 17th, when yet again we're going out to give grants to teachers. We can't thank you enough for all of the efforts of you and the board, and also thank you to the community for your support of our WJCC Schools Foundation. Thank you very much indeed.
Kelly?
Clarence, when I came to this foundation, or when I came to this board 7 years ago, we saw the need for the foundation, and it was a struggle getting it off the ground. I just wanted to thank you for your leadership in making this, getting this foundation viable, for getting it started. The credibility that you personally bring is immense in this community and was critical to this foundation. Your board is a cross-section of community leaders, which also brings additional credibility to that, to the foundation. So, and while Dr. Heron mentioned that the support it provides to our teachers and students, it also provides an outlet for this community to show its support of the schools, to participate in our schools, and to be active in our schools. So, I was at the presentation last year. It's on kind of on my gotta do list now because. It's wonderful to see the reaction of those teachers when they get which in grand terms is really kind of a minimal amount of money, but it goes a long way, and it's meaningful to them. So I look forward to January 17th, and I wouldn't miss it for the world. I thank you for all you have done for the foundation, and on a broader sense, all you've done for this community. So you are definitely a crown jewel of this community. So thank you, Clarence.
I don't think I can beat that, but I do want to thank you and your board and for your service to our community and for guys have worked very hard to make sure that public education is at the forefront of the philanthropic community here in Williamsburg, and for that we can't thank you enough. So any other comments? Thank you very much, Clarence.
Thank you.
Yes.
We can.
Thank you. Katrin. Ms. Rosa, can you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. Now we will move to 9.04, National Mentoring Month. Can I get a motion, please?
I move to approve Resolution R-1-17, National Mentoring Month.
Get a second, please.
Second.
Dr. Heron, would you like to tell us about this?
Yes, this is just a resolution to recognize those who mentor our students in our schools from all different parts of the community, and this is just a recognition that we do annually for mentors.
Discussion? Sarza, will you call the roll, please?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. That brings us to item 10.01, board members' comments. Ms. Taylor, would you like?
Yeah, it's a very exciting day. Very honored to serve as vice chair this year. I'm looking forward to the year and working together closely as a team going forward with the school division's work.
I just wanted to give a shout out to all of our band and chorus and orchestra teachers. So in December, all of our schools had phenomenal winter concerts, and hopefully many folks in the community were able to attend those. I know I was able to attend band, chorus, and orchestra concerts at DJ and Hornsby and Lafayette, and then of course we got to listen to War Hill when we were here at the last meeting. And so just wanted to give a shout out to Related Arts because it is so important. It's not just a fun class, it's an important class. It builds character and skill and team building and collaboration now and in the future. And so one additional thought as we think about program of studies, I know that we have a lot of options for students, which is exciting, but I know sometimes we build an artificial barriers students to access those related arts courses. So if we can just be mindful of that, because I know that there are students, particularly at the high school level, who want to be able to continue to take those courses, and they have to make choices and they can't take those courses. So if we could just be mindful and try to mitigate those artificial barriers, because those teachers do a phenomenal job. And then just wanted to maybe touch base and note, I know there's a parent who wrote in to school board members about concussions and sports and just kind of wanted to touch base and see where we're at with that. I know there's a lot of research about students and schools. And
yeah, we've actually got some information we're going to provide to the board in my communication with them this week. Mr. Paul has done a lot of research, as has Mr. Odstadt. And he's also has been in contact with the parent, and I think Mr. Paul is going to reach out to the parent also.
I wanted to thank everyone for their presentations today. I remember when we moved back to Williamsburg in 2003, my son had spent kindergarten and first grade in Oklahoma, and no offense to Oklahoma, but he was behind all of his peers in Williamsburg when we showed up at Matthew Whaley. And we were very thankful that we were in a Title I school and had a reading recovery teacher for my son. And I I think that the work that our reading recovery teachers do, this leveled literacy, all of our tutors that come into the classroom to get our students reading is so critical. And I just want to put a big thank you out to all of those folks that are on the front lines working with these kids, because I think it's really critical by third grade for children to be reading by third grade, and it just sets them up for success later on in life. So I just wanted to really say from my heart that I really think the reading specialists in our school systems do an amazing job, so thank you. I also want to thank Mr. Clarence. It has been a joy, or Mr. Wilson, for the 30-some thousand dollars that all of our community people have volunteered their money to go to these grants. It's just a great, I guess, feather in the cap for the school system that we have folks in the community that don't necessarily have any kids in the school system that still want to give money to help teachers be innovative. And then last but not least, I wanted to put a plug, and I always read this, Next Door Neighbors. And this month, two WJCC teachers are mentioned in it. Amber Spencer from Spicer from Hornsby Middle School, and Tammy Underwood from Norge. So if anyone gets a chance to read this article, it just gives you an idea of the good things they're doing for our schools as well. So thank you.
Yes, thank you. First of all, this morning the JCC Liaison Committee met today with two distinct things came from that meeting. First of all, we're about to have a budget discussion, but in preparation for the budget discussion, it was pointed out there will be restrictions to the proposed increase to the operating budget. We already know that there's going to be some things that we're not going to be able to avoid, like VRS. They wanted us to understand that while we propose a budget of need, there is eventually a budget of reality. And the second thing is the county is working on keeping their CIP unchanged for the next 5 years. Our CIP for 2018 is over the amount that the county can give us, and we probably need to have a discussion where do we want to go from here. I know that's what has been proposed. Well, two more things. There was a question about, is there anybody on the board going with Dr. Heron to Legislative Day?
I intend to go to Legislative Day. I registered for it.
I did too.
Oh, okay, good. That will answer that question, Dr. Heron. I do want to jump on to the thing about literacy. I totally agree with what Mrs. Hummel said about literacy, and that they're so critical that our students are reading as early as possible and fluently, and I like the fact that they read a book like they talk, because that's important too, where they start really getting the understanding of what books are all about. So I'm excited about the programs that have been developed here and are being utilized to help our students achieve literacy.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly.
Thank you, Mrs. Cook. One last thing, Clarence. Those folks who did donate money, I would encourage them when they get their invitation to reply and come. I think they would really enjoy, probably haven't ridden on a bus in a while, but they might not enjoy that. But, seeing the teachers and the appreciation that they have for those grants, I think is outstanding. And I just want to make sure that those people who donate get that opportunity, because I think that's a great thing. I talked today with our associates from the superintendent search firm. They indicate that we have had 22 applicants for our superintendent's position so far. There's still another week or so open. The applications are open. There are a wide array of candidates, diverse in both racial, gender, and geographic perspective. Position is still posted, so if you're watching this, you're interested, please apply. The bottom line, what that tells us, is that Williamsburg James City County is an attractive school system and an attractive community, and we hope to get more applicants as we keep looking forward to interviewing and selecting our next superintendent. So that's going to be an exciting time and a lot of work for some of us up here. In segueing a little bit into my time on this board, I have never had more confidence in a new chair than I have today. Kira Cook is ideally suited for this position. She's passionate about public education and cares deeply for this community and this school system. I relied on her counsel when she was vice chair. There were more than a few times we disagreed, and she was not shy about letting me know those times. But she was also a good listener to my thoughts as well, and no matter what, your support was palatable and appreciated, and I appreciate that. As leaders, we have to know when there are times for us to be led. I trust you, and you certainly have my wholehearted support as you meet the challenges of this new position. Doesn't mean I will always agree with you, but we can disagree, and we can disagree without being disagreeable or subversive. This board, this school system, and this community is lucky to have you, and I'm glad you've agreed to step into this role. So thank you very much for that. I have had a couple of interesting years as chair. I've enjoyed the opportunity to work with some great professionals, Dr. Constantino, Dr. Heron, and many of the other central office leaders to improve our school system and keep moving our school system forward. I'm still on the board, so I still have that opportunity. I'll still take advantage of that. I have enjoyed the opportunity to represent WJCC in many different forums, gatherings, speaking engagements, and meetings. It is really easy to take pride in the performance of this school system, of our students and our teachers. I am amazed at what they do, and to have had some positive influence, no matter how minor, is really wonderful to me. We have serious needs to address, no doubt, but working together as a community, we can meet those challenges. In some ways, not being chair is liberating. Allow me to speak more freely. Is my intention to participate in this discussion for several more years, and I appreciate all of those many folks who have reached out to me to support me in this role for the last couple of years, and especially in these last few months and weeks. I look forward to working with all the members of this board and the community to continue to keep WJCC as one of, if not the best, school system in the state. It has been my honor to serve as your chair, and I look forward to continuing to contribute for a long time to come. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. I want to thank you, Mr. Kelly, for, hold on just a second, I actually wrote remarks here, there we go. I want to thank you for your leadership on the board for the last 2 years. You've been a mentor to me, for which I'm really grateful. And even when we disagreed, I like that we both used that word, because we did, we kept it about the students, and you taught me that lesson, always about the students, and if you keep it about the students, you always do the right thing. So thank you for that. And I'm going to carry that lesson forward for the rest of my time on this board. Thank you, Mrs. Taylor, for agreeing to serve as vice chair. I really look forward to working with you. And I was going to say congratulations now, not then, so I apologize for that. And also, Mrs. Hummel, I'm looking forward to watching you keep us in good order. So that'll be great. And I want to thank all of you for electing me as chair. I believe that it's the chair's role to be first among equals, and I look forward to working with you and the superintendent as the entire leadership team in that capacity as we work collectively to govern this wonderful division. We've got a lot of work ahead in 2017, and each of us has much to contribute, so I look forward to learning from each of you. Thank you very much. Any other comments? So that brings us to item 11.01, upcoming events. We've got, I wanted to mention that on the 16th of this month, the NAACP is hosting their AXO breakfast, and I believe many of us will attend that. And Mrs. Young mentioned the VSBA Capital Conference on the 23rd and 24th of this month in Richmond, and then new chair and new board member orientation on the 24th, also in Richmond. So those are upcoming events. Any other upcoming events, anyone? And then upcoming meetings.
On the 14th, on Saturday morning, we've at the central office, we've got a budget retreat at 8 a.m. On the 17th of January, we have a closed session here at the Stryker Center at 6, and then followed by a public hearing at 6:30, and then followed by immediately by our regular meeting again. That's all in, here in the Stryker Center. And then February 7th at 6 p.m. at Central Office, we have a closed session, and then following that at 6:30, also on the 7th, we have our work session for February. And then finally, our closed session on the 21st of February here in Stryker, followed by our regular meeting at 6:30. I also wanted to note that we have a meeting scheduled. The time and location, I'm not certain of, but we have on January 23rd a meeting with the consultants as well to discuss. That's in Blair. Okay. On the 23rd. So I wanted to be sure that that was announced as well. So... did I miss anything? And then items 12.01, setting the agenda for the next regular meeting. We're going to be discussing and taking action on the VSBA Code of Conduct, SEAC appointment, and the Program of Studies, which we discussed tonight. Additionally, we'll pick up again self-evaluation, which we had talked about last month, and we've got a few resolutions to consider, among them Black History Month, and of course, as always, personnel and actions and financial reports. So that is it, and with that, meeting adjourned.